Council Carson?
Here.
Council Fritz?
Here.
Council Lynch?
Here.
Council McGinty?
Here.
Council Roberts?
Here.
Representative Dunphy?
Here.
Representative Nelson?
Here.
And Town Manager McGovern?
Yep.
And our municipal clerk present. Pledge of allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, moving on, reports and correspondence. John?
Sorry, I have a cold, so if I don't sound quite right. The County Budget Committee Advisory Committee met last Wednesday. Our final recommendation to the county commissioners was a 19.1% increase. However, they indicated that they would be increasing that from our recommendation. They are meeting as we speak now tonight. They'll make a final budget recommendation tonight. So we'll know tomorrow what the exact amount will be. That's the bad news. The good news, Fire Captain Jim Wilson and his wife Bethany had a bouncing baby boy, Jackson. He's the captain at Engine 1, and Bethany's an EMT on the rescue. So I'd like to welcome him to Cape Elizabeth.
Thank you. Any other? Council Lynch?
He's in.
Thank you. I recently attended the Education Reform Funding Committee meeting, which is a legislative committee in Augusta dedicated to finding some way to provide more local assistance to towns for school funding. And I have very little to report, really, because there's so little money or such a lack of money in Augusta that while this committee, I think, has the best of intentions, and we're quite fortunate that Representative McLaughlin of Cape Elizabeth is on this committee, my sense from the meeting was that despite all good intentions, there will be very little accomplished in the way of reforming education funding on a statewide level. So I just wanted to report about that meeting. There will be another meeting in January, and I'll be planning to attend as part of the Maine Municipal Association Legislative Committee, but I don't think that this will be a year in which municipalities will receive any significant financial relief from the state.
Thank you for the report, if not for the news. Anything else? Any other reports, correspondence? I just wanted to take this moment to welcome the new director of the museum at Portland Headlight. Her name is Jean Gross, and I think she's going to do an excellent job. I participated in interviewing her, and I'd also like to thank Henry Adams, Deborah Lane, and Mike McGovern, who were also part of the interview committee. Okay, Town Manager's report.
Yes, very briefly, in announcing new babies, we also reminds me, we also have an employee who's retiring at the end of this month, at the end of the year, Sergeant Dick Lindsay of our police department, who has over 30 years of service to the department. And those that know Dick always find him an amusing, engaging person. He never minds giving anyone in authority a difficult time. but I know that when he interacts with citizens, he's, you know, very respectful and has just been a great police officer. He was actually the last murder we had in Cape Elizabeth many, many years ago. He was one of the chief investigators of it back in the 1970s. That's how far back Sergeant Lindsay's service go. But he has been debating retirement for some time. He was hoping that we might enhance the retirement benefits for him and for other retirees, and I think he finally gave up that we might not do that. But he has had a number of concerns about the retirement system that he'd be upset if I didn't mention them at some point. So I did want to indicate that he is retiring, and I know he'll have a very happy retirement, and I know he hopes we'll continue to work on retirement issues so that it benefits employees in the future. But he'll will, I think everyone, and I know everyone in the town office will miss his many visits, and he's really been great to work for, and I know Chief Williams, who's sitting quietly in the back row, joins me as well. He's worked with Dick for quite a few years now, and a good person. We'll miss him.
Thank you. Anything else in the town manager's report?
No, that's all.
Okay. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. I see none and hear none, so we'll move on. Yes?
I think I might come on.
Would you care to step to the podium, please?
My name is Jonah Rosenfield, and I'm a new resident to Cape Elizabeth, new to the area. And I don't know if this is appropriate or not, so I'm just asking whether or not it's appropriate. But in a recent newspaper, I noticed the headline being the developer's plans 65-story tower in South Portland. And I was just wondering if it's, I know it's not in the jurisdiction of Cape Elizabeth, but if it's appropriate for the town to make some sort of statement or opinion or some committee within the town to form something about this, either at the meeting that's being called on the 13th or in the development process.
I admit you've got me on this one.
I don't think it's appropriate.
This is not an issue I've thought about a lot.
Yeah, it's not appropriate.
It's not appropriate probably for us. I mean, they'd have to work within the South Portland's own zoning, planning, and all their committee structure. And we can certainly have opinions, but we probably wouldn't publicly.
Okay. I just know as a Cape Elizabeth resident, I would probably be adversely affected by the development of this project. And so.
Thank you.
I just wanted that to be known.
I would concur with Councillor Watson. First of all, it's very early in their process, and second of all, it is. I'm sorry,
Councillor Watson.
I'm sorry, Carson. I don't know where that came from.
That was last year.
God, you were sitting in Ruth Watson's seat.
Oh, no. I'm sitting in my seat.
Brain cramp there. I'm sorry. Yeah. It's very early in the process, and frankly, it is a South Portland issue at this point, but I'm sure they'd be happy to hear your views over at their meetings.
I don't think you need to lose an awful lot of sleep over it, though. I don't believe it stands a snowball's chance, and you know where.
Well, just some of the comments in the newspaper article state that they're very interested in this development, and I think it would just be a really bad thing for Cape Elizabeth and for the area. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Any other citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda? Hearing no others, let's move on. We have minutes from our meeting held November 14th. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
One change on page two. Vote.
Yeah. Page two?
Page. Well, yeah, the vote at the bottom of the page.
Yeah.
76 yes votes, I don't think that.
We were very enthusiastic that night. There were not 76.
Yeah, but I wasn't here. Is this the one I wasn't here for?
Yes, there were six yes votes, but not 76 yes votes. So.
Oh, yeah, probably wouldn't work.
I think we'll amend that. Thank you for noticing that, Councilor McGinty. With that change made, it's been moved and seconded to approve. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Moving on to our first item number 61, we are going to have a public hearing and then take possible action on the proposed list of historic structures. Before we open the public hearing, I'm going to ask Councillor Lynch, who is chair of the Ordinance Committee, to give a very brief introduction to explain what this ordinance is about and not about, and what this list is and is not, just because they're there have been some questions in the past about what exactly we're doing or not doing tonight. So, Councillor Lynch.
Thank you. First, I want to thank all of the members of the public who are out here. I've been on the council since June, and this is the first time I've seen more than one or two people. So it's kind of nice to see you all here tonight. This is really a simple issue. The town has a 45-day waiting period before the owner of a significant historic structure can destroy or renovate that structure. That ordinance applies right now to 89 structures in the town. It was a list developed several years ago by volunteers. In 1999, the Historic Preservation Study Committee, which was a committee of citizens appointed by the town council, recommended, among other things, that the historic list be evaluated by experts using National Historic Preservation criteria. That was done, and after that list was completed, the Historic Preservation Study Committee recommended to the town council that the town council substitute this new list of 199 structures for the list of 89 structures. So what is before the council tonight is simply to substitute the list of 199, or I think there may actually be 196. Some structures have since been either demolished or so significantly renovated that they no longer qualify. So we're proposing to substitute a new list developed by experts according to National Historic Preservation criteria for the list of 89 that was developed by volunteers in good faith but not using any objective criteria. There is no proposal to change the ordinance in any other way, and that simply is what we're doing tonight. So with that, I guess we should open up the public hearing.
Great, thank you very much. What I'd like to do, in the interest of everybody having an appropriate time and amount of time to have their say and speak their piece, is to ask people to come to the podium, please, so that way everybody can hear you also. And please state your name and your address. And I think for this issue, I personally would also like to know if you're in a home that's affected by this list. And then if you could be succinct, everybody wants to say their piece, but please try to be succinct so that everyone else doesn't have to wait a long time. And lastly, I know this seems to intimidate people, but it would be really great if people could line up as opposed to having one person go up, do their thing, go sit down, and then another person comes, because it sort of eats up a lot of time that way. So we're never sure how many people we have left to speak. That would be helpful if it's not too intimidating for the group. So with that, I'd like to declare the public hearing open. So anybody who would like to speak, please come to the podium.
I guess I'll be first.
Thank you.
I'll break the ice. My name is Peter Montano, and I live at 20 Ocean View Road. Been a resident here since 91. And the new list will affect my home, will be added to the list. I guess I actually had a couple of questions that will actually help me lead me in the direction I'd like to talk. First of all, in Chapter 23 of the ordinances for historic preservation ordinance, has that been passed by the council?
Yeah. The zoning ordinance.
The current ordinance?
It's part of the zoning ordinance.
Okay, it's marked draft. I just wasn't sure if it's already been changed.
Was that part of the report?
This came off the internet actually about a year ago.
Maybe I can answer.
We have Maureen look at it.
Could we have Maureen?
No, Maureen. It's not.
Never ever considered. It was drafted for discussion purposes. And remember Henry and Carol, it was never even recommended to the council for adoption.
Yeah, this is
drafted for discussion.
Okay.
This is nothing at this point.
That's why I wanted to make clear before we started that the only thing that exists today is a 45-day waiting period.
Right.
And there's no proposal at all to change that.
Okay. And the 45-day notice period, what is the purpose of having 45 days for to give notice for doing a renovation to one's property?
My understanding is that the purpose is primarily one of educating homeowners and the public. This is what you have. It's a significant structure. So you go to the town, you apply for your permit, and you're told you have 45 days to wait.
It provides an opportunity for perhaps your neighbors or whoever, if somebody else were interested in seeing your property preserved and didn't want you to make any changes to it, they could, you know, raise $2 million or whatever and offer to buy your property. You wouldn't have to take the money, but it gives people a chance to try to educate or make the community aware or perhaps take some action, but it has no binding effect upon the homeowner.
Well, I know with my home, you know, we have done significant renovations to it. We've added a kitchen, an addition onto it. So whether or not, whether it really belongs on the list or not is probably a question. I guess my question is, I know they've developed a list, but no one ever came around to our home and knocked on the door and say, can we see your house to see if it actually belongs on the list? So I guess I kind of question where, is it just based on the date when the property, when the house was built, or was an actual study done of each home to determine whether it actually belongs on the list in the first place?
I think I can answer that. Okay. I was the chairman of the Historic Preservation Study Committee. Okay. We had the experts or consultants go around on the outside. We didn't go inside. The survey was based only on architecture. It was not based on famous people who lived there.
Right.
Or events such as the signing of the Declaration of Independence that happened at Kettle Cove, or some incident that happened. It was not based on anything except architecture. The survey was done by professionals who have done that in other communities, and our committee was pretty diverse. I think no one worked on the committee harder than Councilman Carol Fritz, and she had worked with Landmarks in Portland, and so the result of the committee report was presented, and we felt that the old list was not up to date, and that the professional consultants were in a better position to say what properties were significant and what properties were not so significant. And so that was the way this list came into being. That's the proposal tonight, just to put that list of what the professionals think from an architectural standpoint is appropriate to be on a significant list, a list of significant properties.
So I guess my objection to expanding the list, I'll make it brief, is that, you know, first step is to expand the list. After I had read through this, I was quite alarmed as to the financial restrictions. What had to be done, and the cost I would have incurred if I had to make certain renovations. So my concern going forward is, you know, if we could expand the list, then it's the next step to revise the ordinances to, you know, place additional burden and restrictions on people who actually own homes in the community.
Thank you.
That's my response.
I don't think you have to worry about that, but thank you very much.
Okay.
I'm feeling sort of bad now about all these people standing in line, shifting from foot to foot. If you want to sort of note where you are in line, you know, sit down and hop up, that's fine. I don't want to make you suffer.
Just keep one or two in line.
And I don't think, I'm going to use my discretion here. I don't think that there's any problem with people asking some informational questions, but I just want to make sure everyone knows that this is intended to be a public hearing where we listen to citizens as opposed to getting into a debate. So informational questions are fine for clarification, but I just wanted to make sure everybody knew that. Go ahead, sir, please.
Paulitz Broad Code. This is way
just, you could, yeah, just look it up.
This.
I didn't. I'm sorry, what was your name?
Paulitz Broad Code, bro.
Thank you.
I'm late to this issue. I do not own a home on the list, and I just found out today tangentially to an acquaintance, someone who did. So I really don't have any strong connection to any of the properties that are listed. But I do have a very strong feeling that this is perhaps just the beginning, although the councilors are reassuring us now that it will not lead to further restrictions to people's use of their private property. I do think that these ordinances typically do result in an escalation in terms of what restrictions will be put on people's property in the future. I think it will take just perhaps one hot button property that arises some sort of public sentiment that the person wants to tear it down. I know of no such property now, but at that point, I think the natural progression is to escalate the ordinance to further restrict and somehow curtail the owner's right to do as they wish with the property. I also chafe at some of the counselors' reliance upon the experts, as if that somehow relieves this council of looking at the underlying issue of private property rights. While I generally think that the planning and environmental restrictions in Cape Elizabeth are particularly good for the town, and I think they result in the strictness, I think it results in a very livable community, and I think it results in also a very fair application of primarily the planning and environmental restrictions in the town, I do think this type of restriction is way overboard. And I, from a private property standpoint, I do think this benefits the few versus the many who actually have particular private property interests. And I urge the council to reject this. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hello, my name is Susan Payne, and I live at 72 Stony Brook Road, which is a house that's not on the first list, but it would be on the second list. So I wanted to express my opinion, and I also do have a question that I'd like to ask about the change. I moved here from Cleveland Heights, Ohio, which you might know, Cleveland Heights has very restrictive protections on existing housing, and I'm a big supporter of that. I think it really affects the quality of life in a community to have well-kept older houses. So I do support this change and the broadening of the list. I do have a question, though, as someone who owns a house. In my house, the door was especially highlighted in the description, and I noticed that as I read the legislation, or the change, it talks about demolishing the whole house or a part of the house, and I would hope that if there isn't now some clarification of what is meant by a part of the house, that might be clarified so that people with particular features would know, does it mean a door, does it mean a wing, does it mean substantial demolition? So that would be the question that I would have in terms of whether it includes something like that now or whether that could be added to the clarification.
Ms. Maureen. Oh. Maureen, do you have an answer for how specific? Could you come, Maureen, could you please come forward? Excuse me, this is Maureen O'Meara, the town planner.
The ordinance provision says demolition of all or portion of the structure. So if you wanted to, say, rebuild a sun porch and you tore it down and wanted to rebuild it, if the sun porch was part of the original, and it could be an addition, but if it's part of the historic character of the home, then you would have to wait the 45 days. If you wanted to tear down, let's say someone put a shed off the back and the shed is totally out of character with the home, you wouldn't have to wait the 45 days.
Okay. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is John Green. I'm a manager of the Sprague Properties. I also happen to live in one of the historic homes. I was up at town hall today looking through the new list, and after having gone through the photos, it just seemed to me that it's really not a historic list as we know. It's an architectural list, and it's not a significant list at that, in my opinion. I really think the list should be rejected, and in fact, people could look at this list and really pare it down to significant structures. I think most of these homes are sort of your common, everyday style of, a colonial revival of no significance whatsoever. Although not being an expert, when you look at the photos, you can sort of tell which is which. You know, there are some nice examples in the list. On the property I manage, we have several structures that are on the list, a couple that are now being proposed. Most are not visible to the public. That's a concern of mine. Why should we put together a list and have a 45-day waiting period for those structures that can't even be seen by the public? I also have two that are no longer in existence that are on the list. I have one that is referred to as Garden Elements, a So I have to wait 45 days before I can remove perhaps a garden wall or whatever other elements of this garden that are listed. Also, there was a category that was not on the list that can be checked off. They checked off other and represented also, I guess you'd call them summer cottage style, which took into account a log cabin or any number of styles along the coast lumped into sort of another category that was made, again, not visible to the public. So I also have concerns, as the previous fellow had mentioned, I am a property rights advocate, and I feel it's sort of intrusive. And I just hope there's no ulterior motive here down the road. And I imagine from past experience, I don't see that being a problem, that anything will come of this other than the 45-day waiting period. So thank you for the opportunity to comment.
Thank you very much.
Good evening. I'm Peter Leslie. I live at 7 Cragmore. However, I notice my house is described as 15 Cragmore, and the notice was sent to me at 15 Cragmore. That's a 911 change. In any event, I'm here this evening to oppose the placement of this list, but before I tell you my reasons, I'd like to tell you what I would not oppose. I spent a lot of time studying the hard work that the members of the Historic Preservation Committee put in, and I commend them for their work. I would not oppose a historic district. I think this should be about neighborhoods and not about singling out individual houses. If you don't preserve the character of the neighborhood, you're not really accomplishing much, in my opinion. I would not oppose an architectural board, which many towns have and employ successfully without too much cost, in which all changes, demolitions or otherwise, would go through a process which would be fair, which would be speedy, but which would have the aim of preserving the character of the neighborhoods. People who know my house know that my wife and I have put an enormous effort into preserving it in the style in which it was built. And I think to some extent, those of us who do live in what are called significant houses are not the ones that you should be worried about, because we've been doing our job, by and large. But in any event, we're very concerned that people next to us would be able to do pretty much anything which would destroy the essential character of the neighborhoods which we prize. Now, why am I opposed to simply taking this new list and placing it in the existing ordinance? First, I don't think it's a historical list. I think the volunteers who composed the first list had a greater sensitivity to what this town is about. People who've lived here, sometimes for more than 10 generations, people who have farmed here, people who have lived in this community and worked in nearby Portland, famous people, people that weren't so famous, but I don't think we ought to brush off the volunteers' work so quickly in favor of what is simply a course in comparative architecture. And that's what this is. This is a list of, if you were going to give a course in comparative architecture, you would drive people around and show them these houses and say, this is a colonial revival, that's Greek revival, this is Tudor revival. Is that really what we want to accomplish? Now, there's no provision in the ordinance for placing these new houses on this list, and I think there should be. I think the citizens should have input, I think the owners should have input. I think it was a $5,000 study, which was a pretty quick study for something of this scope, should be the basis for placing these names quickly without more consideration into the existing ordinance. I think you ought to separate the town properties from the list and focus on the fact that about 170 of these homes are private homes. The others are public properties which you already control and you can preserve, and I hope you will. I think we need criteria, and I think that would require considerable input and more than we have so far. I asked the Historic Preservation Committee to provide an example of a town, that a suburban town in America that went around cherry picking a certain number of architectural properties or architecturally significant properties, and so far I haven't seen that list. I looked for it myself on the internet. But I don't think there's precedent for this. And I'll speed up because time is flying, but I think also we need to have some provisions for special situations, like handicapped access. Let's say somebody who lived in one of these homes had a stroke and needed to demolish something in order to gain access to their own home. 45-day waiting period? Publish things in the paper? I don't think so. I think at least we want to consider it. Finally, my major objection to this is that we're simply perpetuating what is, I believe, poor public policy because it hasn't been effective up to now, as far as I know. Has it? To me, it's an irritant to both the owners and to those who would seek to preserve our heritage because it doesn't effectively accomplish anything. So I think we ought to look at it from that point of view. If it's the thin edge of the wedge, as some say, well, that's a battle that could be fought another day. But to those who think it is, I would say it isn't going to work. We have to take this on in a much more systematic way. I think there has to be a decision on the part of the town that architecture is important to the town, that singling out properties is important to the town, and I don't think we've done that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Leslie. Next, please.
Good evening and hello. My name is Chris Bozek, 20 Ocean View Road. My house is on the impacted list. I just wanted to bring up a few brief points here. First off, I think consistent with some of the earlier comments, I think there's a very gray area here in terms of architectural distinctiveness and historical on this list of homes. My home, you can make a very nice argument, it has some architectural distinctiveness. It's not historical. Secondly, my neighbor to the front, back, rear, all four sides of me, their homes are not on the historical list. So therefore, I have this encumbrance of a burden, whereas my neighbors around me, quite frankly, do not have the same burden. And I think the value is a neighborhood concept versus one individual home. And secondly, even though I have absolutely no reason to think otherwise that this mandate goes nothing more than the 45-day waiting list, I think we saw the future, and the future was in that original November of 99 draft, which showed where this bill can potentially go for, where this concept can potentially go to. People change, times change, the members of this board will change, and this council will change. And having my house lumped into that historical district and the perception or the perspective that my home might be adversely impacted by a fully developed historical replacement cost concept, quite frankly, is economically burdensome to myself, economically burdensome for insurance that I need to get for my house, and quite frankly, will reduce my property value because I know I would not have bought a house which had these levels of onerous restrictions on my home if I knew that, if that was a conditioned precedent of me looking at my home today. So I really very much encourage the council to take a very strong hard look at this reform. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, please.
Hi, I'm Hillary Bassett. I'm here representing Greater Portland Landmarks. First of all, I'd like to commend Cape Elizabeth for commissioning a professional survey.
Excuse me, just a second. Are you a Cape Elizabeth resident also?
I'm a resident of Portland.
Okay, thank you.
I'm here representing Cape Elizabeth as the director of Greater Portland Landmarks. First, I'd like to commend Cape Elizabeth for commissioning professional survey, which identified 196 properties of architectural significance. It's an impressive list that contains properties from the 1700s to the 1950s and styles that reflect the history of American architecture from colonial to Italianate, shingle style craftsmen to the international style. This is a rich architectural legacy that Cape Elizabeth has and gives it its special identity and special character. We urge the council to adopt this list of 196 properties for use in its zoning ordinance rather than the original list of 89. The 45-day demolition delay provision in the ordinance is an important first step in the town's effort to preserve its historic properties, a goal set forth in your comprehensive plan. It is critical that the delay provision be applied to the full range of architecturally significant properties as identified in the list of 196. The demolition delay provision allows time for public notice, for public comment and for consideration of alternatives to demolition. As Portland discovered in the case of the case of Tracy Causer Block, today a vital office and retail space, demolition delay is essential to saving architectural fabric. You have to save the building first before you can consider alternatives for its use and preservation. We also want to help. Landmarks is pleased to make available our Peabody Research Library, our education programs, our historic marker program, our advisory service, our awards programs to provide guidance and recognition to owners of historic properties in Cape Elizabeth. Long term, we encourage the Planning Board and Town Council to consider broadening the degree of protection for historic properties in ways that work best for the citizens of the town. As development pressures escalate and threats to the historic properties increase, you may want to consider adopting a historic preservation ordinance, because that would be the most effective way to preserve the historic fabric of Cape Elizabeth. But for today, we urge your support to adopt the list of 196 for your zoning ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next, please.
My name is Randy Blake. I live on Ivy Road in Cape Elizabeth, and I represent an owner of one of the 89 original structures. I have a couple of questions first, and then a couple of comments. Does the current ordinance provide for a 45-day notice for renovation? I didn't think that was in the original ordinance, but I participated when that was drafted, and we fought with a lawyer very hard to make sure that the town, that there was no positive action required in the town, just on the demolition side. And I don't recall anything in there regarding renovation, so that's a new expansion to the
I'll ask Maureen to confirm that, but my understanding is it does apply to renovations.
My understanding of the way that the building inspector is administering this, it only applies to demolition. So if you wanted to strip all the shingles off and put something else on, you could do that.
So that's an expansion of the existing ordinance, which was not there before. What under proposed, it would apply to renovations, not just demolition.
That is not what she just said.
Just to clarify, no, she says it just, she said it just pertained to demolition, so pardon me?
Then and now.
Then and now.
She said when she read the thing, renovation.
But I perhaps was using renovation.
In terms of demolishing.
In terms of, demolishing a wall or
wing.
Something, a wing, and putting something else up. And so maybe we're using the terms differently.
Well, renovation, demolition, you can demolish all or half. Renovation, that project on Shore Road, looks like a major demolition, but it's basically a renovation. So how do you categorize that? And that's a renovation necessitated by the poor structural.
Could we get Ms. O'Meara to come back and comment, please?
Yes.
Clarify, please.
I did speak with the code enforcement officer regarding the house on Shore Road that everyone's asked about. That house is not on the current list, was not subject to the 45-day demolition provision that's currently in the ordinance. It is on this proposed list under consideration. If it had been on the list that's currently in effect, just to do the renovation work, they would have been able to go ahead and do it. But once they started tearing down a whole level, that would have triggered the 45-day demolition delay.
Even though it came as a result of finding problems with the renovations.
My understanding is that the builder did tell the code officer that they might find some structural issues with the roof and that they might have to do some demolition. But it wasn't on the current list, therefore it wasn't subject to the 45-day delay.
So the current ordinance, which is the same as the proposed ordinance, since we're not changing the ordinance itself, the only thing we're dealing with is the list, is that it just pertains to demolition.
Correct.
Okay.
Now, some people, when they renovate, that involves demolishing. Some people renovate without demolishing.
So it's demolition of the whole building or a part of the building.
Right. And anything on the interior of the building is not covered under this provision.
And something like changing the shingles or the roof, something that didn't involve demolishing.
If you just wanted to re-roof, that's just go ahead and do it. I think he's dealt with some people who, say, wanted to take some old rotting shingles off and put new rotting shingles on, and he hasn't treated that as a demolition.
Okay. Does that clarify for you, Mr. Blake?
Yes, as long as, Peter Leslie's house has slate shingles and he wants to replace it with asphalt shingles, is that the same thing as historically changing the house?
It sounds to me like that would not be a demolition, but not
my other question was, what percentage of the houses in the town does 200 homes represent?
Does the 200 what?
200 properties represent the number of houses in the town.
3,000 houses.
3,000 houses.
Ms. O'Meara?
How many homes are there in Cape Elizabeth?
It's like
33,
34, something like that.
It's closer to 35, 36.
Okay.
100.
Okay.
Yes.
So this is less than 10%. And then I thought Peter and some other gentlemen did a very good job of highlighting some of the points I was going to make. The lady from Landmarks really caused me concern, following up on the previous speaker, that this is the first step in the historic process. And that's a major concern for me, and I think many people in this town, that it is the beginning of the wedge. I've attended Mr. Barry's meetings. I sat through most of those and found them interesting. I attended the public hearing, sat through the presentation by the experts, and I think looking at the slideshow that they put on, and it really wasn't a demonstration of historic property, it was a demonstration of architecturally interesting property. And I think there's a big difference between historic and architecturally interesting. I think the new homes on Shore Road are very architecturally interesting, and now that they're there, should they be preserved, or are they historic structures? And does the demolition of those change the neighbor or neighbor, the character of the neighborhood? So I think the criteria has fault in it. It was done by some experts, but those experts, I think, have invested interest in historic housing. I know the group. They say we saw the slides, and there was a finite line sometimes between what was acceptable and what was not acceptable. So I think to base this list on the research that's been done would be a great disservice to the owners of those homes and the town. There's no consistency within the thing. The list, you have a variety of properties. They aren't consistent within the neighborhood. There's a little blocking within the town. But as Peter mentioned, there's no zone or anything that presents an architectural consistency. These properties are scattered site and throughout the town. So I don't see how we gain a lot from that. The report has incorrect information in it. Reading from the one that the property that I manage, it says that just one point, well, one, it's an older house, granted that, but it had a major renovation in 54 when an L was added. It has vinyl siding. So the addition was majorly renovated in 54. And then it says in here, the windows throughout the house are 6/6. That's not true. Top part's 6/6, but all the bottom panes are one large pane. That's just one example of misinformation within the description of the property. I think we also need to be sensitive to the needs of the owners other than just historic needs of the town. Owners, the example was given of a handicap accessible. An owner may not be able to replace, because of the cost, a component of the property. Slate roofs cost 4 to 5 times what a shingle roof cost. So if those things need to be replaced, then you're placing a financial burden on the owner. I do think historic ordinances have a negative impact on the value of the property, and if the town wants to preserve them, they ought to give a tax incentive to the owner, because I myself would not want to buy a historic property because of the aggravation of having to deal with a commission for anything I wanted to do. A good example of that, I was looking at a property in Portland the other day. It's a commercial property, and the owner wanted to retrofit some very old windows. The building was very inefficient, and he wanted to use green trim. And the historic ordinance bought him, they wanted black trim. The architects and engineers said black holds the heat a lot longer, makes it more concentrated, and the heat will break the seal in the windows, and caused a vapor barrier to break down, and the heat started to break down. He fought them and fought them, finally just put the green in, and I'm not sure whether it ended up in litigation or not, but that's a prime example of what some of these ordinances can get to extend to. I don't think the town needs this list. If you want to do it, I think you start over and just look at properties that are truly historic, and I think there's probably less than a dozen in the town. You don't need to burden the owners of all these properties with this process. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Blake. Yes, sir.
My name is Dick Perkins, 39 Cottage Found Road. I guess perhaps my problems are been answered, but for example, my house is Tudor style. It's got a curved doorway entrance. I just got done doing a lot of work on that property, and I'm looking at perhaps having to do something about the door. Now, if I want to just make that a standard door, what am I going to run into?
I'm sorry. I thought that was a rhetorical question, but...
I'm looking to see what...
Ms. O'Meara?
Is that demolition or just a change?
If you're going to be changing the shape of the door, I expect that the code enforcement officer is going to consider that a demolition because you're going to have to rebuild the frame. We had a conversation last week about window frames, so I'm assuming he's going to feel the same way about door frames. So you would have to advertise your change and wait 45 days. And then at the end of the 45 days, you could go ahead with your work.
Oh, okay. All right, doesn't work that way in historic district. If you get one of those in, you've got a problem. It's hard to work with. I moved here from Thompson, and we saw all kinds of problems in historic district. People trying to do things, such as put in windows that are thermal protection and so forth. But no, couldn't do it. I would say leave things alone.
Okay. Thank you very much. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Sally Mason. I'm at One Surf Road in Cape Elizabeth. And I do have one of the houses on the new proposed list. I wasn't even going to get up here and speak because I thought the people that did speak on behalf of their own homes did such a fine job. I would reiterate that I see no significant historical value to my house for this town. I do like my house. I bought it because it's an old house and it has nice features to it, so I certainly am not interested in changing a significant part of the house. But if I did want to, I think it would be my own say-so that that should happen. It's not over 100 years old. Yes, there are some architecturally nice features to it. That's why I bought the house. I don't see any reason why that should put that on the list of homes where now I have to ask permission, wait 45 days, advertise it in the paper. And I assume that's at my cost. What's even more disturbing, and that's why I'm up here, is I've listened to people ask questions, and it's very clear to me that nobody knows what this ordinance really means. Ms. O'Meara has come up here about 3 or 4 times to try to give clarification. I'm not sure I'm even clear on that clarification as we stand here. And I heard one comment that she made that if something were to change, or if you wanted to demolish a part of a home that didn't fit in with the character of the home, that would be okay. You wouldn't have to wait 45 days. Who makes those decisions? I don't really feel comfortable with someone putting my home on a list without some better definition. I feel quite offended. I work hard. I'm at work most of the time. I don't pay as much attention to the town business as I probably should, but I'm quite offended that the first time I knew my house was going on this list was a week ago when I got the mailing. I had no notification prior to that it was even being considered for the list. So I am opposed to this, and I also am opposed to the process in which this list was put together. And I do not see that these homes that have been listed in walking around my neighborhood to look at the homes on the list fit into what I would consider historically significant homes.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir.
Peter Eastman, and I have no intention of making drastic changes to Turkey Hill Farm. However, I would like to say this. This PA system may be great for you, but you can't hear a damn thing back there. So I suggest for 45 days we have another meeting that you alter this system. Thank you.
You're welcome, sir. Do we have anyone else who would like to speak? Mr. Blake.
No one had trouble hearing you, Peter.
Please speak up.
Break it, Rich.
I just wanted to follow up one small point that I failed to mention my time up here before, but I thought it was important. The property that I manage is just down the road here, and it's located right next to the real estate office, which has been zoned commercially. So this house is a residential house. It's been a residential house for 100-something years. And now the town ended up, the town took which was the farmland and built the high school on it. And just recently, the town zoned the area around it commercial. So, and they've approved a large expansion of Mr. Tinsman's property as a restaurant and several other things. That hasn't come to fruition yet, but the approval's there, and that has a severe negative impact on the livability of that property. So I think if you, you're going to have this ordinance, you need to give consideration to what things the town does that impacts these properties also. And I think that zoning change down there had a negative, my wife's family wanted us to buy it and move into it. And I said, I'm not living on that busy road with a commercial property next to us. So the highest and best use for that in the appraisal terms is not a single family house anymore. It's some sort of commercial use, whether it's multifamily, whether the town spends more money and takes that property for additional fields or something like that. It's certainly not a residential property. The best thing would be to do would be to move it. Not demolish it, but to move it.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir, please.
I'm still Peter Leslie, 7 Cragmore. After I sat down, my eye fell on these three photographs, and I'd just like to hand them to you while I speak. I took these photographs when the committee was meeting earlier of my own house, and it's a good example of one of the points that I brought up earlier, that each one of us, I think, at a minimum, ought to be allowed to address the issues that have to do with our own particular houses. These photos show how our house is practically invisible to the public. These pictures were all taken when the trees were bare, so you can see what can be seen from Shore Road and from Casino Beach, which is practically nothing. So I would just ask what interest the town has in this course in comparative architecture in my house, if it can't really be reached except on a private way or by water, you know, by the public in general. And I suspect that the 170 or so private homes have this type of question to a greater or lesser degree. And I think each of us should be given input into that before you simply pass this new list into the ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Not sure if I dare ask again. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? No. Then I declare this public hearing closed. Thank you very much. I appreciate that the council appreciates very much everyone taking the time to come out and express their views. We want to let you know that we will consider your views very carefully. And now we need to move on to any possible action on this. Councilors, do I hear any motions or discussion?
Motion or discussion first?
We can put the motion on and then discuss. I don't know. What do you want to do?
Usually.
There's no motion to table.
Pardon?
Just a caution. If anyone makes a motion to table, that cuts off discussion. So if anyone's planning to make a motion like that and you still like to hear some discussion, you might want to hold off from making that motion.
Right.
Who are you going to take? Is that what you're going to do?
No.
Oh,
speak. I was in discussion. I'm sorry.
Oh, go for it.
I'm not going to move to pass it, so go somebody else better.
Does anyone want to make a motion? Does anyone want to discuss?
Maybe I need to clarify what.
A chat?
I'll discuss. I think I just have to lay it out here. I'm so conflicted on this and have been for such a long time. This all started from people who said, gee, we have a lot of beautiful properties in this town and they're being torn down rapidly. This is not talking about people's personal property rights. And we look through towns that were historic, that aren't there anymore, and we realize that the ambience of a town is very often in the look of the structures that are there, albeit the fact that they're owned by somebody other than yourself. So that is how this sort of all thing started. We wanted to sort of protect this ambience of this town from this sort of thing. It was an innocent beginning from my point of view. At least I was not on the committee at all. And so when I came here tonight, I thought, oh, well, we're going to change the list from the old list to what is now considered a more accurate list. Now I'm again conflicted, and I feel that this is very difficult for me to support for several reasons. As I listened to some of the people speak, I can't remember which gentleman spoke and said his house was a house that was on the list and the four or five houses on all around him are not on the list. So he's the only one out of all those people who would have any sort of restriction on it. And all the rest of those people could tear down their houses and build some unbelievable monstrosity there, which would devalue his house anyway, and he wouldn't be allowed to do anything to his. Or do, you know, he would be restricted in something he could do. So I thought about, gee, we'd be losing the ambience that I'm thinking about anyway if everything around his neighborhood was changed. So it came to me that was not a very fair assessment in his particular. He lives in a neighborhood where most of the houses are on our list in that whole Mountain View Park area. So I also listened to the people that talked about the difference in an historic structure and a structure that has some architecturally pleasing aspects to it. Now, I took it all on face value. I wasn't on the council then, and in the beginning, and I say, well, this company came here, and they're historic, and they're known for that, and they put these buildings on the list here. Well, I figured that they knew what they were talking about, but there clearly is a difference between something that's architecturally attractive and something that's historical. I think there's a difference. I have to say that on things that the council or get on this type of thing, I would very often take this list and I would drive around to these neighborhoods. I'm originally from Cape Elizabeth, and although some of the names have changed, I probably could find most of these houses. And I don't think Nikki Williams and I ever thought that our houses on Charles Road would be, but they're old, 1908, I know that. Those were old houses. So I suppose maybe I should drive around and look at them. There's twice as many houses. When I look at this and I think of the roads that they're on, there are literally a lot more than I ever anticipated would be on it. So are they historical, or is it because the architectural firm liked some architectural aspect of that house and therefore put it on there? So it appears that somebody said, and I tend to agree with them, that maybe that there are too many houses on the list, and maybe they're not all historical, even though they may have some architectural aspect about them. And then there's the criteria, which several people spoke about. I just put face value into the architectural firm that they had a list of criteria, and maybe the committee did, because I was not on the subcommittee of the council. What was the criteria, and was it because the three people or two people, whatever it was in the architectural firm, liked some architectural part of that house, so therefore it made the list? Was there some criteria that was applied evenly throughout the town? Now, I'm really conflicted about it, and I actually feel that although I arrived here tonight with this simple thing, we were going to replace one list with the other list, and that seemed reasonable to me, it does not seem reasonable to me anymore. And I don't know that I can support this.
Okay. Councilor Fritz, you were sort of next in line. Do you still want to make a comment, or I've got Councilor Robb?
Well, I'd just like to mention that the committee, I was on the study committee that was involved with this, and we had three major forums where people came forth. We presented information on what the housing stock was what was being considered in terms of the houses specifically, and also we brought forth the ordinance that you brought up, because we really explored historic ordinances all around the state and various aspects, and we had a couple of workshops with the council. And we did get the message that people wanted to preserve property rights, but also felt that the historic character of the town was very important. And I think the council really gave the committee the message that this should be a voluntary ordinance that was primarily based on education, educating the homeowner and the townspeople, and also providing some incentives to this list of people who had these interesting houses and historic houses. And I think that the committee came back with exactly that kind of proposal. It really is based on education, and unfortunately, some of the proposals that the committee made, I don't think we've, one of the reasons we hadn't adopted it before this was because we didn't have the money to provide some of those things. We've talked about providing people with plaques so that they have some pride in their house. We've talked about, during that 45-day waiting period, you could either come to a committee to listen to advice from historic architecture, people who could help improve your house or show you ways that you can do what you want to do, but do it in a way that fits with the style of the house. Not to say no, but to help through the process of designing your change. Or we also, probably the cheapest way was to provide people with an architect who might review their designs for a couple of hours, and the town would pay for that. And there probably would only be four or five a year, and that would be a pretty inexpensive, actually, thing to maintain the town's historic structures and help people out. So those were incentives in education. And that, I think, was the intent of having people on this list be able to get an advantage of incentives. But at this point, we don't have that.
Thank you. Councilor Roberts.
Thank you very much. I'm pleased to say that I'm not conflicted at all. I came here this evening having heard at the last public hearing person after person after person getting up and saying they did not want to be on a list. And I heard them loud and clear. Last month at our council meeting, I voted not to even bring it to a public hearing, so I regret people had to come back out again. I'm not even sure that everybody that was on that list was notified because of the address changes that we had, but perhaps they got it even though they had the wrong address on it. I suspect if they had gotten it, maybe there'd been more people here. We're not talking about public buildings. We're not talking about commercial structures, and we're not even talking about buildings so unique that they are irreplaceable. I mean, you go through that list, and there's one after another of the same style of architecture. And Peter mentioned about it being an ineffective irritant. Well, I can tell you, if you go out and you've started to do some work, and you're not aware that you're on this list, and you're going to get your building permit, you get your contractors all lined up, and somebody tells you you've got to wait 45 days, you better believe they're going to be irritated. It is an unfair burden to people that have houses all around them that aren't on this list. I would support a district if a petition came from that neighborhood and that they were strongly in favor of such an action. Then I could be convinced that that would be the way to go. But the process that we have here, it's unfair, and it does not accomplish what we want to do. It's very ineffective, and I would not support it in any form, shape, or manner as it's now presented.
Councilor Lynch.
Thank you. I'm not too conflicted either, but for different reasons. My concern, and one of the main reasons that, as a member of the Ordinance Committee, I voted to bring it here tonight and to have this public hearing, was that we have an ordinance that is somewhat burdensome to property. And the question I have is, if we have this ordinance, does it apply to the right properties? Mm-hmm. Now, I understand that it applies to 89 properties that were developed without objective criteria. And the proposal was to have it apply to approximately 200 properties that were developed by experts through objective criteria. And I don't want to suggest that I'm just saying let the experts decide, but my understanding is that they use National Historic Preservation criteria. Having said that, though, if the council, and I respect what people said tonight, I am a private property owner. I would not want someone telling me what to do with my house and how many days I would have to wait. My sense is, though, if it's not going to apply to the properties, that at least through some objective criteria, should it apply at all to the 89? And if I were to make a motion tonight, it would be that the list would, or that the 45 days would apply only to federal, state, and town-owned property.
Is that a motion?
I'm just suggesting that that would be a motion that I would make tonight, and I would move to take out the 89, because I do think it's unfair to have it apply to 89 houses that ended up on the list. Maybe some of them are historic, some of them aren't. I've seen some of them. Some of them are on both lists, but there are some that aren't, and they're there through happenstance. To me, that's objectionable. So were I to make a motion, it would be to delete the 89 and at this point have it apply only to any federal, state, or town-owned property.
Second.
And I would also say that I think the
I think she was saying if she were to make a motion.
If I were. I would also say that from my experience, the town has been the actor in this town that has done more to destroy historic property over the 25 years. When I think about Fort Williams and some of the other properties, so my sense is that that would be a good starting place, and if we want to have an ordinance with some teeth, we could apply it to town property first. But I don't want to burden private property rights. It was a fairness issue for me. So that's where I am on this.
Thank you, Counselor.
And I'd be glad to make a motion, but I...
Well, you can if you must, but I think we have some more discussion, so people want to weigh in. Counselor McGinty.
I guess the buzzword tonight is conflicted. I was not conflicted. This came out of committee on a 2-1 vote. I was the no vote to bring it to the public hearing. I can't say any better than all the people who have spoken tonight or the other counselors, the very various reasons. I believe in people's private property rights. There's no criteria how to get on the list or get off it if you want to be on the list. There's no way to get on, and there's no way to get off. It's just kind of, you know, these experts made up this list, and that's it. You're on or you're off. And it is. It's not a historic list. It's an architectural list, in my opinion. I would rather see us go back to the list of 89 and clean up that list, see what should be on there, if it's historic, if it's state or federal or municipal properties. I obviously don't support this.
You do support it or you don't?
I do not.
Councilor Barry, do you wish to say anything?
Council is a representative form of government, and if we are to represent the majority people in the town, I think that what has been said here tonight has made clear the feeling that they don't want to do this, so I would not support it.
Councilor Carson.
The fact remains is that there are many communities that have, including, I mean, try to imagine the old port, if it wasn't the old port, try to imagine what the buildings would look like. The fact for me remains is that there are some beautiful things in this community, some beautiful structures in this community, and there is nothing in place to protect them. And so be it. Maybe we shouldn't be protecting them, but you lose the essence of a community if people just come flying in saying, oh, I like this location, I hate this building, I'm just going to tear it down, which is, of course, what has been happening anyway. And that, of course, is their right to do it. But you do lose this heart, soul, and essence of a community when you have no historic look back. If everything is new and everything looks like it has, the new houses have six architectural styles on them anyway, including all the windows and the peaks and the gables and everything like that. Maybe that'll be some wonderful architecture. Maybe 100 years from now, somebody's going to be sitting up there saying, how are we going to protect these cottage-style houses that were built in place of that Tudor house? I don't know, but I feel it doesn't look like this is going to pass. I myself remain conflicted. I'm conflicted because I believe that there should be something to protect the essence and the heart and soul of your community. And obviously, this is not it. And obviously, this is not going to fly. So while we sit here and figure out what it is, and while we vote no, they will be torn down. There will be less and less of them as the years goes by, and maybe that's it. I'd like to think that this originally came from some members of the community, and I'd like to think that there were some members of the community who maybe would relook at this and maybe look at districts, and maybe, because there are some neighborhoods that would fit into that, and maybe there's something we can do that's what I think to protect the essence of the community, what makes us what we are, but I don't think it's what we have tonight.
Thank you. I'd just like to say that I have sort of been with this issue for a while. I, too, have attended all the public hearings and public meetings and various forums on this subject, and I still have all my notes that I took on every speaker who spoke at those, and I've received a number of emails and letters on this issue. What I did note was that last year, 75% of the people who spoke against a non-voluntary sort of ordinance or a non-voluntary sort of list. And tonight, I heard 8 people against, 1 person for. At least 6 of the people who were against it were on the list, so will be personally affected. I have grave concerns, in somewhat along with Councillor Carson, that it's like mom and apple pie. I'm all in favor of historic preservation, but I am also very aware of the importance and believe strongly in the importance of personal property rights. And I am not in favor of any mandatory putting people's homes on a list. I am not in favor of mandatory sorts of ordinances. We may indeed be giving something up, as Councillor Carson says, but I think we give up more when we force people to do things with their own homes. There has been no opportunity for due process, in my opinion, with the with this list. There, as far as I know, there really wasn't any opportunity for anyone to challenge their being on this list. The architectural experts did use national criteria, so I feel the second list is better than the first list was, in that I think it's more accurate. But that doesn't mean I'm in favor of the list. Owners should have had input. I would like to see if there is any list, that it's voluntary. I will not be voting for this second list, but I agree with Councillor Lynch that I don't think the list of 89 is appropriate either, because I think it's inaccurate and it puts the same sort of restrictions on people in their homes. So I would like to see this apply to the state, federal, and municipal buildings, and then I would like to consider that if people want to voluntarily put their home on a list, they could do so. I think it's sort of pointless, but frankly, the ordinance as it stands today, the 45-day wait, is a pretty toothless ordinance. So I'm not sure having a list means anything at all at this point, but I cannot support the new list. But I also cannot support the first list, other than the municipal, state, and federal properties. So that's where I am. Councillor Lynch.
And on that note, I guess I would like to move the deletion of all property on the list of 89, except for any federal, state, or town-owned property, because I do think it's a fairness issue.
Second.
Wait a minute, this is the list of 89, which is not up for discussion,
that's
right?
That's right.
It is.
She just made a motion.
But my concern is that if we're not prepared to have this 45-day ordinance apply to a list that, for better or worse, was developed with some criteria, it ought not to apply to a list that was developed without any criteria. I find that even more difficult, so that's my motion.
Okay. So it's been moved, and did I hear a second? Yes, Jack? Is there any discussion?
I wouldn't be able to support your motion, primarily, I think, because I don't believe this 45-day waiting period on the list of 199 is an onerous problem. I think people can possibly improve their houses by listening for 45 days, and then they can do whatever they want. I just don't think it's an onerous thing. There's no way that we will save every house on that list. We were not able to save Two Lights Keeper's Quarters. But I think that there are some that we will save. And just by bringing and educating the owners of the houses during that 45-day period. I would agree that town properties, I mean, the town has not protected its property all that well, and I think somebody suggested taking town properties off, but I think town property does need to have controls over it. But I think the entire list is appropriate for being included on the list. And don't forget that we went through the whole, I mean, we proposed the idea to the planning board of doing away with the entire list. The planning board unanimously said no, that this is important to do. We would be taking a very important step backwards. When many towns have very strict ordinances, which this committee, the Historic Study Committee, did not propose. It was a volunteer proposal that was made, and this is volunteer that you're considering. So,
is there any, Councilor Roberts?
People have made reference to the town not being a very good steward, but I'm not sure what town parcels we're talking about. I know that some of the buildings at the fort had to come down because by the time we got them, they were so dilapidated that they couldn't be saved, or the cost was so prohibitive. Yet, if we couldn't afford to repair a dilapidated building, how would we expect one of our residents, perhaps living in the same building, to do the same thing? Could somebody tell me what buildings we've been so careless about?
I'd like to ask the town manager, too.
I have to admit I've been cringing at the two comments that have been made that the town's not a custodian of our buildings. I think one only needs to look at the significant amount, over $500,000, that was spent on the restoration of Portland Headlight about 11 years ago, restoring old windows, taking off aluminum siding, replacing all the boards. Certainly probably our most historic property. If one looks at the former Pond Cove School Annex, that's now the Thomas Memorial Library, Penny and others, I know were back on the council at the time, that building, very significant building, was saved. The Thomas Memorial Library, the old Thomas Memorial Library, was converted into the Children's Library and, again, is a tremendous resource. The school construction project of the early 90s made sure to improve and enhance the front of the old high school, the middle school. Certainly a beautiful structure.
This one here.
The building particular right here? Town hall, this town council over the last couple of years appropriated funds to take off the vinyl siding and to convert it to the boards, all except for the back of the building. If you even look at this room, the investments that have been made to keep the architectural elements here and some of the town's history. So I know we did tear down an old farmhouse that was way beyond repair at the Gulfcrest property, that we did have the historic preservation volunteers walk through, and they agreed with us that it needed to be torn down. Back in the 70s, many of the offices, row buildings, were torn down, but But if you look at the history of that, the town offered it to Greater Portland Landmarks to see if they could find reuses of those buildings, and they never did, because they, you know, they admittedly had to admit they were too far gone. So, in that, we recently tore down the fire station, which I'm not sure that had any architectural significance. And I think at least the new building, even though it's big and expensive, will have some architectural significance in years ahead. So I think the town has a pretty good record of maintaining
its historic properties.
For that reason, you know, if the council was inclined to place a 45-day waiting period on municipal properties, I don't see where that would be at all a burden.
We couldn't make a decision in 45 days anyway.
Madam Chairman, what's the sense? Why do we need this 45 days at all? If we're not going to have it on any houses, we're just going to put it on town properties. The town properties are well taken care of. Why do we need this 45 days? It didn't come from this council. It came from about 10 years ago. I don't see any sense of the 45-day waiting period at all.
Well, after we deal with this motion, if you'd like to make another motion.
Right. You have to send that back to the ordinance committee.
I'm going to vote against this motion because I don't think it should be restricted to town properties. I don't see any sense of it.
Okay, let's...
Well, we're in a discussion here.
Yes.
I don't know if there's anything we can resurrect in an effort to do something that we think is significant in trying to protect the ambience of our community in some way. Is there some way that the list, we've heard a lot of criticisms, we don't like the list of 89, now we don't like the list of 196 for a variety of reasons. Is there some way that we can work over either of the two lists to come up with what we think is anything? Or is it just lists in general that nobody wants? Is there, are there any structures in the community that, I mean, I think Peter had a value. We say we protect the house that he lives in, which nobody can see, or there, I guess there are a couple of other people. And so maybe that's not what we're talking about. Is this something we can do with a list?
I personally hesitate to just do something with the list because I'm frankly not qualified to do sensible with the list. The whole reason I understand, because it happened a few years ago, that we hired a consultant, an architectural consultant in the first place, was so that they could look at the list and apply so-called objective criteria to it. And they came up with a list of 196. I think we're faced with an issue here of, are we going to have a list, no list, or some version of the list? The motion before us is to cut the list back, I believe, tell me if I'm wrong, is to cut the list back so that it applies only to state, federal, and municipal properties that have been identified as architecturally significant. It would not apply to private residences or any other buildings businesses or any other buildings in town.
May I ask a question?
Well, certainly.
If I give up the floor.
Well, that's...
You can have it, Henry.
Take the floor.
No.
Take the rug.
I'm just not quite finished, but I am. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, Penny. I thought you were. Yes, Henry.
My question is, what jurisdiction does the town of Cape Elizabeth have over federal or state property?
Exactly. I was going to say the same thing.
It would just be protecting the sandwich shop at the state park.
Yeah, I think I can answer that one.
Manager McCullough.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
I don't think there's a single federal property on this list.
No.
Exactly.
I think the federal property, I think the only building they own in Cape Elizabeth is the fog signal building down at...
Two Lights.
Right. As well as the tower at Two Lights,
which is
a protected National Historic Landmark, the tower itself.
How about Portland Headlight?
No, we own that. We own the lighthouse. State property, there was a new law passed... 2 years ago that did subject the state to municipal review of their project, so they understand that would be an obligation, and those have been on the list, those 89, would continue on the list. It's not adding a new burden onto the state if there's a motion to retain it.
So, Councillor Lynch, do you want to amend your motion to make it only state and municipal properties? Since there aren't any federal properties on the list.
I'll amend it to have it applied to state and town owned properties
that have been identified as architecturally significant.
Okay.
I'll withdraw my second then on the prior one, so.
I'm sorry?
I had a second on the other one. I'll withdraw that.
You'll withdraw your, so you're not going to second the amended one?
I'm not seconding this one. No. I just want to have it just eliminated.
Does anybody want to second that? I'll second it. But it doesn't look like we've got the votes. Let's vote on it and just get rid of this issue.
I'm wondering whether this is really the forum to discuss, to whittle this list down. I mean, we've talked about a number of options with the committee, with the ordinance committee, like cutting off, you know, colonial revivals, or because there are a lot of those and that wouldn't affect, if we did that, we wouldn't affect that many people. I guess I'm just thinking that maybe a workshop is a better place to discuss that. So I guess I would make a motion to table.
It's not the man.
That cuts discussion.
So point of clarification then.
Yes.
We bring it back up. Do we have to have another public hearing so people will know whether or not they're going to be on the list or not?
If it were changed, I would assume so.
I think we have to have another public hearing.
Could I just make a point of clarification? If this is seconded, we cut discussion right now and we can't discuss it and we can't do anything more with it tonight. So just to clarify.
Just also to answer Councillor Roberts' question, there would need to be probably a second public hearing on if it was tabled, because at that point would be a new proposal coming forward and you would be proposing to eliminate the 60-odd homes on the list that are not state and local properties. However, it would be in order tonight because to do it, I'm not suggesting it be done, but it would be in order to do it because what was set for public hearing was removing the 89, so you could do that in whole or in part, and adding the 200, so you could do that in whole or in part.
You mean in whole or in part of the list?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Okay, I would just like to say I am frustrated because this issue has been going on for so long, and I really sympathize with all the poor people out there. My house is not affected, but I really feel the need to provide some closure to the citizens on this. This has really gone on and been discussed to death, I think, and we keep hearing the same input over and over again from the public that the majority do not want mandatory or non-voluntary restrictions. And so I would really not want to table this. I would not want to have a workshop on this. I think we've had several workshops on it. We've discussed the issues over and over again, and I really would like to move forward and vote so we can put this one to bed for the citizens.
So did I hear the manager correctly that we could make a motion to eliminate the list of 89, period?
That was part of what was set for public hearing, was to delete the list of 89.
Yes. I move to remove the list of 89.
There's a motion pending to table.
What? No.
It hasn't been seconded.
It hasn't been seconded, no.
So it loses.
I hear no second for tabling.
You have to rule on it.
So did I just rule on it? The motion dies.
All right.
Okay. Thank you, Henry, keeping me honest.
So I move to remove to...
But did we ever... Do we have to... Help me with the rules of order here. Do we have
to... The floor
to,
is open
do we have to
another
vote? The floor is open. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Then I would move we remove the list of 89 and no longer have a list, period.
I'll second.
No longer have the list of 89?
The list of 89 or the one that was proposed.
That's a motion that
so
you
that's
would
a motion
both
to remove both lists.
Correct.
I was the chairman of the committee. I'll second that.
Thank you.
Councillor Lynch.
May I speak to that? I really want to resolve this tonight, too, because there are many property owners who are interested in this, and they're in this room, so I hope we can resolve it one way or another. But I will vote against that motion, because despite the fact that the town has done a lot of good things in terms of historic preservation, I think that... if we are interested in historic preservation, we ought to have... And a 45-day wait period is not terribly burdensome. We ought to apply that to town-owned property. We have some of the most significantly historic property in the town, starting with Fort Williams. So
I would oppose that because I would like to see a 45-day wait period so that we could have time to gather public opinion when the town decides it's going to demolish some significant structure.
So what's on the table at this point? Getting rid of both
the
lists?
The entire list.
Was there a second?
Yes, that? There was.
Henry, I thought you
Henry.
Second that. Is there any further? John?
Well, I mean, I agree with Marianne. I really do. I think that our buildings, so that a future council, you know, no reflection on this panel, but that a future council might, you know, in a fit of madness, try to destroy one of our buildings overnight without any input. So I kind of agree with Marianne. So.
Well, I too agree with Councillor Lynch that I think the 45-day wait should apply to town buildings.
But we can't vote on that.
But I thought can we vote on that?
It's not in his motion.
It's not in your motion. You have to vote
yes
down.
But we could have another motion.
Mm-hmm. Good.
I thought Carol tabled that, but
it was, her tabling was not seconded.
The table never got seconded.
She didn't table it.
She didn't table it.
There wasn't a vote on the table.
There's only one motion before the floor, and you can either vote that down and then put a new motion on that includes right what you guys want.
Okay. So there's a motion on the floor to get rid of both lists.
No, get rid of the list of 89.
Get rid of the list of 89 because we haven't voted the other list on yet, if we even do. Okay. Is there any further discussion? Shall we move? Remove the question. Okay, all in favor? All in favor?
Okay.
Two. So, all opposed?
Okay. So now you can put a new motion before the floor.
So, now we have not gotten rid of that one. Do I hear another motion?
Should I try to resurrect my old motion?
Please.
Which would be to delete from the list of 89 and the list of 200 all property except the state and town-owned property.
Second.
So what? Let's, you know.
Right. Second.
Okay. It's been moved and seconded to have the list include just the town and state-owned property in Cape Elizabeth. That came from the list as architecturally significant. Is there any discussion on this one? Carol?
I don't know how many homeowners are here tonight that, you know, maybe 10, 15 houses actually on the list. And everybody, almost 200, got a notice of that this hearing was going to be taking place. So that's certainly not a majority of the people who are going to be on this list. It's 7%, something like that, if my math is right. The committee, the Historic Study Committee, did a survey, and 250 people responded in the town. It was put in the Cape Courier, and people could respond. 93% of the people said that they were interested in historic preservation. When asked whether the town should protect historic structures, 85% said yes. When they said, the question to are there buildings worth saving, 76% said yes. How many buildings in town do you think merit historic protection? And people really didn't know the number that ought to be protected. If you support the concept of historic preservation, should it be voluntary or town regulated? 42% said voluntary. 47% said town regulated. And should there be historic protection of privately owned houses? And 47% said yes. I don't think that we have a huge number of people who have actually, you know, turned out tonight that are saying absolutely no protection, and you're about to do that. And I hope you don't do that.
Any further discussion?
Darn it, making it more difficult for me.
Try. So the motion on the floor is for the town-owned and state-owned property to be the list, basically.
This is not saying that we can't ever do anything to protect historic structures of the town. It's just saying that we can't do this with this list. It's not to say that this cannot, something cannot come forward again, either in a district form or something else. Mm-hmm. So by voting for this, I'm not saying that's it, we're throwing all these houses to the wind.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know how the Historic Study Committee could have been any more thorough. I don't know what you would want them to look at.
And I commend them for their work, because I know it was a lot of work that they did. I don't know how we got into this mess tonight, because we are.
Shall? Yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify that I understand the motion to be, if it's a state or locally owned property, municipally owned on either list, it would be on the replacement list.
Yes. Okay, everybody clear on what the motion is? All in favor? Four. Against? Three.
Okay. Well, I just a little point of information. I think it was something that John said, that that it would take a long time for municipal-owned properties. When they were taking the Goddard Mansion down, we had 3 days.
I know.
We got the report on Friday night. They were taking it down practically the next week. So they can happen fast. But it didn't happen. Because I laid down in front of the tractor.
I didn't list that as one of the major achievements of historic preservation.
I noticed
you
that.
Bet.
I noticed that. Okay. Is, just to make sure, are we done with this issue? Are there no more?
No. I don't think we're done for good. We're just done part of it for tonight.
For tonight.
Done for good.
Okay, I want to thank everybody. I know it's been a struggle up here, and I appreciate everyone's input and comments, and I'm sure we'll hear more in the future. Councillor Carson is correct. This may well not be the end of this issue. If any citizens want to initiate any historic districts or any other
things, here's the sign-up list right here.
Any other historic preservation actions, they are perfectly free to do so. So thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it. I'm going to suggest we just take a one-minute break, because I know some people will want to leave the room.
You're getting a regular check, too.
Well, not until I have it.
Not until you deposit it, yeah. It's yours.
I want to cash it somewhere. Hmm. And if it's drawn on a local bank, I'm going to take it to that local bank and
cash it. They can instruct, I believe.
I don't want anybody interfering with the relationship between me as an employee, not me as a counselor, but I mean as an employee of the town and the town. I don't want a third party interfering with that relationship.
I guess I'll address my question to the town manager. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd like to comment on Councilor Berry's motion. Thank you for directing that. I had proposed the direct deposit only for new employees after a certain date, and the employees, you know, quite the ones who are against it feel strongly about it for a whole lot of different reasons, some personal, some other reasons. And I don't see this as an issue to offend employees over. If I want to pick a battle with the Public Works Union, I'd much rather pick it on a more significant issue. We really don't have any savings on this issue, and it is something that I think, you know, keeping with some of the earlier discussion, we might best move to by a discussion over time,
right,
as to it being a better arrangement and not unilaterally force it at this point. So I would, I agree with Councilor Berry's sentiment on removing this, although not exactly with all his legal interpretation of attachments.
But an employee can still make a choice for direct deposit.
They can still make a choice for direct deposit. Okay. We I think we need to more actively encourage them to do it and understand the benefits of it, rather than unilaterally saying any new employee, tough, you have to have a direct
deposit. I don't want it to be mandatory. That's all.
Just one Council additional Roberts. Question in a minute. Just for my enlightenment at this point, if the state were to contact you and say garnish their check, they can do it, can't they? They don't have to. They may never get the check if the state comes in and says we want it.
I don't want to get into a legal debate on garnishing of checks, because that's, I don't really think that's the issue before the council.
We don't want to raise that specter.
I don't have much expertise.
Move the question.
It's moved and seconded. All in favor of doing this all except for section 3.1.15. It's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you for the support.
Okay, marching onward. Item number 63, sewer connection fee for affordable housing units. Mr. McGovern, would you like to say something about this?
Within the zoning ordinance? Yes, within the zoning ordinance, we have something called mandatory affordable housing provisions, and it requires developers, if they have subdivisions that are over a certain limit, so many of them need to be set aside either for moderate income or low income, and depending on if they choose moderate or low, there's a different number of housing units. Anyway, the developer of Cross Hill was looking at this and discovered that, you know, once he really got into the project, he's about to move forward on these, discovered that not only is the developer and, you know, the owner of the property fully donating all of those five lots, they're also needing to subsidize the actual construction of homes beyond, you know, above and beyond what they're able to get for them. So he came forward to us and said, you know, you see his letter here, that they ought to have sewer connection for free, to the effect that the town also ought to be contributing. I didn't agree with that it ought to be free. He also pointed out, since they had actually footed the whole expense of putting sewer in, the whole sewer extension, as well as the sewer through the neighborhood, that it ought to be free, and again, I didn't agree with that. However, I do think that the town does have an affordable housing issue. You know, there are issues with, you know, people being able to live here in Cape Elizabeth, and that we ought to do our part as well in providing this affordable housing mix. And one way that can be done is by reducing the sewer connection fee from the $3,000 that's for all other properties, and I recommended that we do it $1,000 for these properties. As I've written it, it would not apply simply to Cross Hill. It would apply to any future subdivision that has these mandatory housing provisions, so that right up front, everyone who's involved in that will know that the connection fee is $1,000 and not $3,000. So I think this would, you know, be a positive development in terms of the town, you know, doing something to deal with affordable housing. It doesn't affect the property tax. This is all out of the sewer accounts, and, you know, they still would be contributing $1,000 per unit and becoming sewer customers and paying those full sewer user fees once they're connected. But, you know, there are many other communities that, you know, I was just approached this week with donated lots to Habitat for Humanity and other endeavors, and up to this point, Cape Elizabeth, you know, other than enacting the ordinance, putting the burden onto the private sector, has not directly as a community given any break to these affordable housing units. So I'd recommend that you do that through having a $1,000 sewer connection fee instead of the $3,000.
So moved.
Sorry. Is there a second?
Go ahead. You were going to make a motion.
So moved. That the $1,000 fee be the limit or the price to for any sewer connection for mandatory affordable housing connections.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Perry.
Yeah, just a question. Aren't we, in a sense, subsidizing the developer here who has set his price and cost up from the beginning of the plan? I don't know.
That could be interpreted that way. In this, you know, that would apply to Cross Hill as proposed. But, you know, this is drafted to apply to everything in the future, and they'll know this. In this particular instance, I think it's fair to say that it was a much more onerous burden to the developer than he had thought that it would be. That frequently happens, and we usually, you know, don't bail them out. But, you know, our contribution in this, in the case of Cross Hill, is 5 units times 2,000. You know, we'd still be receiving 5,000. Indeed, from the development, we're going to be, in addition to the sewer extension, the new homeowners there and the developer will be contributing $270,000 in user fees, and this is, in connection fees, and this is a break of $10,000 for that $270,000 in total fees.
Further, Carol.
Is this fee of $3,000 set to cover costs of the town? Are they related to the cost of, to the town for connection? I mean, does the developer make the connection? Do we make the connection?
In these particular, you know, in new subdivisions, which all of these apply for, we require them to pay for the sewer extension, and the individual homeowner pays for the building sewer extending from the road to the property. So we have no new expense. However, the connection fee for all properties is meant to, in part, meant to do two things. One is to raise revenue to add to the overall pool,
you know, right,
as everything else does. The second thing is to recognize that they are connecting to an overall sewer system, including a treatment plant, a pump station, and sewer lines, that while all of those other systems are depreciated, and depreciated considerably, there still is a value there that they're getting that someone else has been paying for over time. And that's why we have the connection fees the way we do.
And I guess the other, I wish Maureen was still here, because I'm trying to remember how the ordinance works with affordable housing, but it seemed to me that if they put in affordable housing, they get additional units of other houses. So that's their incentive, that's their assistance for providing affordable housing. Now, maybe I don't recall how that works.
These are the mandatory affordable housing provisions, and either you pay a fee in lieu of that goes into a fund, or you provide the units. These are mandatory for the major subdivisions.
They're not getting extras. They can't get, they have to do a certain percentage. I think it was 5%. It's 5% for development?
Yeah. It's a different percentage if it's low income or if it's moderate.
But the five, if you're doing Cross Hill, I think a 5% had to be mandatory.
It's five units out of about 96 in the case of Cross
Hill. Which is close to 5%, yeah.
Well, I just think it's a cost of doing business. I mean, that's the way it was approved with 3,000. Yeah. I think it ought to stay the same for all the units.
Yeah.
You know, the property was purchased with that provision, and I don't see a reason to change it.
Does this pass, will this be passed on to the buyer? Is the developer going to eat this, or will the buyer eat it?
That's negotiable.
We deal with that issue all the time. I remember dealing with it with the sewer connection fee for the multi-units. And, you know, really, we have no way of knowing whether, you know, we don't know what the individual contracts are, whether or not the contracts for the home say that the buyers pay the sewer connection fee, or whether or not it's a developer. No matter what those contracts say, that's always going to be a point of discussion and a shift. And, you know, a buyer's going to pay so much, and a seller's going to sell for so much. And, you know, they can play whatever games they want as to how they shift those funds. So it's all part of the equation.
If I might just comment again, I this money goes into the sewer fund. And aren't we making improvements to the infiltration and that sort of thing? Wasn't that one of the reasons that we increased the fee the last time? And so what we don't, essentially the town will be able to do less, $10,000 less in infiltration correction and impact on the treatment plant. So I really don't see any reason to reduce the fee.
Councillor Lynch.
I guess for the reasons stated by Councillors Fritz and Barry, I am uncomfortable with this. I would support this on a prospective basis, that is to apply to subdivisions that have not yet been permitted, but I'm not comfortable applying it sort of retroactively to a subdivision that already has its permits and to a developer who presumably price this when he was coming up with his plans. So.
Any further discussion? No? It's been moved and seconded to do what? To make this proposal apply to not to these five units and also to all future units. All in favor? Zero. All against? Unanimous. Yeah, me too. You're against, right?
No, no. We're for.
You're against your own motion.
We're against.
Oh, I'm against, right. Against.
Against?
Okay, just clarifying. It was unanimous, no.
Can we, do you want to do it, Sarah?
I would move because I am very much in favor of doing what we can to encourage some affordable housing, that we approve this prospectively to subdivisions that have not yet been permitted.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion?
Yeah, I've just worded that. I've added to paragraph 3 for subdivisions approved after January 1, 2002. Is that the intent?
Yeah.
Okay.
After January. Nothing going to be improved between now and January. Mm-hmm.
Is that your intent, Councilor Lynch?
Well, my intent would be if someone came in tomorrow, it could apply. I don't.
If
there's nothing coming in the next 3 weeks, then that.
New subdivisions?
Yeah.
There'll be a rush tomorrow morning.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to think.
No, they'll wait 3 weeks.
Wait 3 weeks, yeah.
I don't think there's any subdivisions due to be approved by the planning board this month.
I'll make it today.
So it's January 1, 2002, is that what you're saying, Marianne?
Makes no sense.
I was just hedging a little bit on Frustaci, but I no way that's going to get approved this one.
Okay. If that's
does he have affordable housing?
Stick your gun.
I don't think he does.
Immediate.
So
immediate? Why don't we just make it today or tomorrow for anyone who comes in after tomorrow? Then we won't trap someone in this.
Right.
December 11th?
Yeah.
So December 11th or after?
Yep.
Okay. Councilor Fritz?
Well, I would, I just think all units need to contribute equally to the sewer, what is it called? Sewer
budget.
But yeah, the budget for taking care of the treatment plant and the infiltration. And I think we're encouraging affordable housing by requiring it. But the expenses, I think, need to be covered.
I think I'd like to encourage it a little more
by
contributing to the cost. I agree we are encouraging it by mandating it, but I think this will encourage it even further, and I think affordable housing is a definite need in this community. Okay. Any further discussion? It's been moved and seconded that effective December 11th. Okay. All in favor? Against? 6-1. Thank you very much. Okay. Item number 64 has to do with parking on Oakhurst Road near St. Albans Church. Would you like to say anything about this?
Yes, this was also a letter from Steve Parkhurst and his wife Ann, happens to live right there. And as you can see from the photographs, and the chief of police has been waiting patiently all evening as well, there is some congestion on that curb, and there's a proposal to ban parking on one side of the road right around the curb from Waverly Road back 400 feet. You know, I would strongly recommend that this be referred to the ordinance committee for them to look at it, maybe do a site visit with the chief of police, with any other interested parties. You know, we're very sensitive about any parking regulation near a church. We've spoken to the church, the minister spoke with the chief of police and is supportive of the change, but I'd really encourage you to go out there and as an ordinance committee and to make a site visit and to make a recommendation to the council on this.
Madam Chairman, I move that this matter be referred to the ordinance committee.
Second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? No? All in favor? It's unanimous.
Are we going to write an ordinance for this?
No.
What it is, it's an amendment to the traffic schedule that there's a whole long list of where parking's allowed and where parking isn't. And the ordinance committee, if they were so inclined, would recommend an addition to that traffic schedule that says no parking on the northerly side of Oakhurst Road from Waverly Road, 400 feet easterly toward Shore Road. What it would read.
Nick, would you like to say anything after sitting here all night?
Councilor.
Yeah, I did speak, call the priest at St. Albans today, speak to him about this, and he certainly agrees. I think it was warming to know that in the last 18 months, the church has gone from 350 members to 800 and something.
Jeez.
So, and this did not happen after September 11th. So that was one of the things. The other thing that I asked about this, because I asked him, it's a sort of a pet peeve, and probably the chief knows that this is one of those things, and I certainly would, the next time I get a chance to speak to Steve Parkhurst, I would say that why not neighbor to neighbor go to the church and say to them, this is a problem, can you help us? But everybody in this town goes directly to the police if the dog barks, or if the, you know, I just wish people would deal directly with neighbors. And so, because I did speak to them at the church, and they have been very good neighbors. The parking lot is used for Beach to Beacon, it's used for the symphony, they open that up for everybody. So that they have tried to be good neighbors, and I think that this will work when it comes back from the ordinance committee. So.
Thank you. Moving on, item number 65, the naming of Tote Road.
Yeah, these residents, 251, 257, under the addressing ordinance, they need to name their driveway. They want a Tote Road. Needless to say, this is also the name of a ski run at Sugarloaf, so we're very concerned with this name. Nonetheless,
if they plow it, it's
signs have a way of disappearing. But anyway, this looks like a very reasonable request, and there is nothing in Cape Elizabeth called Tote Road. And
do I hear a motion?
I move that the private driveway near 251 and 257 Spurwick Avenue be designated as Tote Road.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? I think not. All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Okay. Item number 66, In by the Sea annual licenses. Ms. Lane, would you like to say anything about this?
Yes, thank you. In your packet, you do have the completed licenses. They are renewal of the malt, spiritus, and vinous liquor license and special amusement permit for the lessees of Susan Legg Events and Fort Fairfield Yacht Club at Inn by the Sea. Sue Legg was here earlier this evening, and probably because of family had to get home. And I have checked the code enforcement and the two public safety chiefs, and they see no problem with the renewal being approved.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Just a quick question. I didn't know Fort Fairfield had a yacht club, but I guess they do.
I guess so.
I support this motion.
Okay. All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
It's a prairie schooner that they have up there.
I guess it is.
Okay. Item number 67, Fort Williams Park Use Family Fun Day. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded, just for the sake of everyone out there to know, to reserve Fort Williams Park for Saturday, June 15th, for the 2002 Family Fun Day celebration. Any discussion? All in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you. Item number 68, the annual acceptance of donations. I would just like to say I was very impressed by this list. There's a list of donations by department since December 1st, 2000, and I added them all up, and it was over $116,000. I was very impressed by the public spiritedness and generosity of our, what I presume is mostly our citizens who have donated to the playground committee, the benches at Fort Williams, the thermal imaging camera, the police department, dugouts, wet team, fire department, on and on and on. It's a very impressive list, and I just want to thank everyone who has donated on behalf of the town. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded that we accept this list of donations as presented. All in favor?
Go ahead.
All in favor? It's unanimous.
Just one quick note. Somewhere there was a message here, yeah, Debbie wrote it on page 3. This did not include additional monies that also were collected by the fire department that went directly to the New York Relief Fund.
I saw that.
The chief cites $22,901.90, and that was just the, it was actually more than that when you took both the checks and the cash. Remember how much it was? It was up around 40 almost, I think.
Did it get that high?
Yeah, 30s.
Wow. 38.
Yeah, 38 or so.
It's really impressive. Okay, item number 69, replacement of 1998 transfer trailer. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, this is actually, as Bob's memo indicates, 1988 transfer trailer.
Oh, excuse me.
That was my mistake. That was my mistake on the agenda. I think this one's fairly straightforward. This item would go out to bid, actually. Did you all get these photographs in color? Mm-hmm. As you can see, it is severely rotting underneath.
Rusted.
You know, any other year, I would have come forward and said, you know, would you please appropriate the money out of surplus?
Right.
This year, under the financial constraints, we're operating under a policy that I'm not even going to propose anything to the council unless we can first show that we're saving money elsewhere. And in this instance, would be saving money elsewhere by deferring two projects for $54,200. So I'd recommend that you authorize us to purchase a replacement transfer trailer at an estimated cost of $53,000 and to cancel two capital items as contained in my memo on December 4th.
I move that.
Second. I moved and seconded. Is there any discussion?
Just one comment. It looks worse in person. I went up and looked at it. The pictures don't do it justice.
It's really scary, huh? Councilor Fritz.
I would certainly agree that this it obviously needs to be replaced, and it wouldn't be good to have only one trailer running. But I guess, you know, over the years that I've been on the council, it seems like we end up having to replace our equipment because of major rusting. And that's obviously a problem around here, but I just wonder whether when we get new equipment, whether we couldn't, you know, coat it with something that would help,
not that
you know, prevent some of this rust. Because I think 10 years to have to, you know, to only expect a life of 10 years is not really adequate.
If I might, I would agree for this piece of equipment, and I'll mention that to Bob to make sure it's in the specs to ensure that everything's galvanized, rust-proof, whatever we can do. It is always going to be a problem with those trucks that that handle salt you know, directly, but, you know, this truck does not handle salt directly. It handles most everything else.
But it does, I mean, I can understand. I mean, it takes a lot of pressure from that, you know, the compactor and there's wet trash and all that sort of thing, but.
All that wrapping paper.
Okay, is there any citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda?
Yes, no.
I hear none. Do I hear a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Did we vote on the truck?
I don't think you voted on the truck.
Oh, I'm sorry. getting excited.
No, oh, did we vote on the trailer?
Let's go backwards then. Item number 69.
Did somebody make a motion for that?
It was moved.
It was moved and seconded.
I did.
And I heard everyone agreeing. So, all those in favor? It's unanimous. There is no citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Before we adjourn, I would just like to note that the council will be having a workshop meeting and a special town council meeting on Thursday, December 13th, a few days from now.
The agenda. I'd like to wish everybody a very Merry Christmas. That's not on the agenda.
Thank you. The agenda of the workshop is going to be to review plans for new community center. And this is also going to include looking at revenue sources for the operation of the building. And the agenda for the council meeting on Thursday will be to consider setting a public hearing for January 14th, 2002 on a proposal for the new community center. And there will also be an agenda item to receive and act upon a report from the Appointments Committee regarding vacancies on boards and commissions. So, that said, now do I hear motion to adjourn?
I'll move to adjourn.
Second? Been moved and seconded, all in favor?
On Henry's comment for Merry Christmas, I think we better add a Happy Hanukkah and a Merry Kwanzaa or whatever as well to anybody, or whatever else you're celebrating this season.
We're going to set aside a special room for you.
Thank you very much.